Welcome to Up, Up, Down, Down. I'm your host, Austin Creed, and on this next episode of Save Point, we got a man who has been on the show before. He is a friend of the channel, he's a friend of mine, and probably, I'll say the most talented person that I know, that I've ever met in life, James Iagheart, ladies and gentlemen, the Tony Award-winning Broadway artist extraordinaire is here.
My God. He has
blessed us with his presence on Up, Up, Down, Down. Thank you, sir.
Brother, I am so glad to be here. And that may be one of the best intros I have ever received. Thank you so much. Most talented. I mean, my gosh, man. How can you say that? You know, Charlotte Flair.
You've won a Tony.
That is very true. That's a very real thing. That is true. That is true. But you know, you are, you know, many time champion, you know. So when I look at talent, it's hard to put together.
Out of here. We're gonna get into all Seriously. The stuff that you've gone through to get to where you are today.
Sure.
We're gonna do all we play with Gauntlet. The Slayer edition. You wanted Gauntlet, we got you Gauntlet.
Oh, thank you. This is the game that my wife and I love playing video games together, and it got hard after a while. So my wife and I finally found this game, and it's like, loved it, and refound it, and replayed it again. We literally just played it like a month ago and beat it from start to finish and had a great time.
Well, I have yet to dig into this one. So.
Really?
I'm excited. I know, very much so. Okay, so we go campaign, and then I jump in with you?
Sure, let's see.
Oh, what difficulty you want it on?
Normal, because I got to talk to you.
All right.
I mean, we can go hard, and then you know you'll just be like, James, huh? What?
Yeah. Oh, constructing the gauntlet. Oh hell yeah, let's go. Ooh, okay, Valkyrie, wizard, elf. I feel like I'm gonna go elf. I'm normally an elf
really?
Guy.
You know, it's funny. I'm always wizard, but my wife is always warrior or a Valkyrie. So I think I'm gonna do Valkyrie, so I can like you know fight up front.
All right, James. So for people who are not familiar with your illustrious career, could you give us some of the things that you've been a part of? Some of the things that you've done.
I have been on Broadway for almost over a decade now, and everything from I started with. 25th annual Putnam Spelling Bee when I first started in New York City, 2007. Then I went on to the Tony Award winning show, Memphis. And then I went on to win the Tony, which is crazy, in Disney's Aladdin as the genie. I am the original genie from Broadway. And now I am in the juggernaut Broadway show. Well, when it gets back on, Hamilton. I play Marquis de Lafayette and Thomas Jefferson.
So incredible. So incredible.
And that's just Broadway. I mean, if there's any, you know, cartoon fans out there, if you've been watching Rapunzel's Tangled Adventures, I play Lance Strongbow, and soon, very soon, DuckTales. I can't say which character, but I will be featured on a two episodes of DuckTales, which I'm very excited about.
So you're all over the place, because I feel like a lot of times in the entertainment industry, you see someone and they gain notoriety for like one specific thing usually. And you, as you just stated, have experience doing so many different kinds of things. Like, how did you go down this route? Was it something that you wanted, or did you just want to sing? Did you just want to be, did you just want to dance?
Like, what brought you here? I really wanted to do it all. The funny thing is, I knew my mom and dad were performers before my father retired from being in films. And my mom is still she's a retired music teacher. So everything was music with us and I loved it. But I knew I was going to be on stage somehow. I just didn't know how. And the crazy thing is, when I was about 10 years old, I saw this thing called professional wrestling and thought for sure I was going to be a sports entertainer. And yeah. I was so sick of high school. That I saw, I think it's Pretty Boy Bobby had a school in Hayward, California called APW, which is still there actually, All Pro Wrestling.
Yeah.
And it was during Raw. I went down to the school and got all excited because I told my mom, I was like, I'm sick of school. I'm going to be a professional wrestler and that's what I'm doing. And went to the school and got to meet Roland Alexander, God rest his soul. He was the promoter. And, he got me in the ring and we talked and I asked him a crazy question, which answered my question of how I was going to be a wrestler. I was like, hey, how do you do the blood? And he was like, what do you mean? How do you do the blood? And I was like, well, no, how do you do it? Like, you know, is it like a pack? What do you do? He's like, actually, the blood is real. I was like, what? No, he's like,
yeah.
He goes, you'll learn that when you get here, but the blood is real. And he had this thing called Garage Wars. And so every Friday and Saturday night, they would have, you know, the students wrestle. And I went to Garage Wars and I saw a brother as dark as us. And I saw a brother chop him in the corner and there was a handprint on his chest. And I went, oh, this mess is real. This is real. I mean, I understand, but oh my God.
I'm not doing this.
And I thought, I decided I was still going to do it. My father said, look, please get a college education. Please get a college education. Yeah. He goes, if you still want to be a wrestler after you get your degree, then go right ahead. And I fought the family business, man. I was like, you ain't going to get me singing, man. I'm going to do my own thing. Got to college, got in a musical, the whitest musical you can get into. I got into Oklahoma and I was like, well, this is my career. And I've been doing it ever since. Seriously, it was like, oh, Oklahoma. Like, oh, this is it. This is life. And the bad part is, I thought for sure, the bad part is I was like, you know what? I'm going to get back to wrestling because I know I'll get more hurt in wrestling than I would in musicals. And I've been doing it for a long time. And man, I got injuries. Yeah. I talked to you and some of the other ladies and guys who wrestle. We all got the same damn injuries. And I was like, damn, I should have just jumped in the ring. But yeah, you know,
just stayed.
It was the path that the door opened and I was where I was supposed to be. And I'm glad because I get to sit back and enjoy what you guys do. Yeah. But oh my God.
Okay. So Oklahoma is, where you found your real
love. It was a college show. I mean, I always loved musicals from when I was a kid. The Wiz, that was the first one I saw, and I knew I wanted to do it.
What was your favorite song in The Wiz?
Oh my God.
There's only one answer.
Several times. I'm the Mean Old Lion.
Really?
Mean Old Lion.
Really?
Yeah, because I wanted to be Ted Ross. Like, everybody wanted to be Michael Jackson and wanted to do You Can't Win. But yeah.
Oh my God, what a song.
What's funny is I completely identified with the lion so bad that my mom, when I was a kid, for the church talent show, made me a lion costume and I sang Mean Old Lion for the church. And she still has it, which is so funny because in 2009, we actually got to do it in New York. With Ashanti playing, Ashanti, the R&B singer, playing Dorothy, and Orlando Jones playing The Wiz.
No.
And Don Lewis, and Don Lewis from A Different World playing Ada Pearl. We had Tony Award-winning LaShans playing Glinda. It was dope. And also, I was like not known. So there was this young cat named Josh Henry and this other brother named Christian Dante White. And nobody knew who the hell we were. Now, Josh Henry is two-time Tony nominee. Christian just got through acting with Bette Midler in Hello Dolly. So
that was definitely the jump off.
Yeah, like folks knew who we were. After that moment, folks knew who we were. We had made it. We had definitely shown the world who we were, and it was a really, really cool moment. It was a great time.
So how did you end up getting that gig?
Would you say that really
started at it for you?
Basically, I mean, I was doing stuff already, it was the first time New York got to see me not doing, you know, replacing somebody, because I replaced my best friend Derek Baskin in Spelling Bee when I took over Broadway. But the crazy thing was Tommy Kail, the director of Hamilton. We were doing Free Solo Supreme, and this place called City Center asked him, what show would you want to direct? And he said, I want to direct Free Solo Supreme. Oh, Free Solo Supreme is a hip hop improvisational rap group that has a really cool crew of brothers. It was started by Anthony Venenziali, Tommy Kail, and Lin-Manuel Miranda. And they started this group. And basically what you do is you throw words at us and we improvise an entire hip hop show. So that's basically what it is. And one of our newest members is Wayne Brady. One of our members is...
Wayne Brady's in now?
All right. Yeah, Wayne Brady joined. Wayne Brady joined. We were off Broadway. Wayne Brady, Davi Diggs. If you've ever seen that movie, Pitch Perfect, the Indian guy. Utkarsh Imbakar is one of our members. If you're watching and you have kids and you watch Sesame Street, the musical director for Sesame Street is one of our keyboardists, Bill Sherman. He was there before he joined Sesame Street. So our crew is pretty deep.
Oh my God, I bought the soundtrack to Pitch Perfect before the movie was over.
So like
I was
in
the theater losing my mind so hard.
Utkarsh and I auditioned on the same day. And we both got
absurd.
That's insane. And so Tommy was directing they asked me if I wanted to direct, and he calls me up. I'm in California, and he goes, "Yo, man, you want to?" I keep dying. You are so much better than me than this. He says, "Yo, man, you want to do?" He says, "You want to do The Wiz?" I said, "Yeah." And he said, "Well, look, you can't just get it. You have to audition." And he goes, "I'm not gonna lie to you. You know, Jackson really wants the line." I'm like, and I said to him, I said, "Look, Jackson and I are friends. I was the best man at his wedding, but he ain't taking this role for me." So, so I auditioned, got it. Jackson's still mad. It's been years, and he's still pissed off at me. and that's how I ended up getting into The Wiz, and it was like a 2-week show, and it was supposed to be a concert. Like, oh, you have your music in your hands. Nah, man, we did a full on show. The choreographer of Hamilton and In the Heights, Andy Blankenbuehler, was the choreographer. Alex Lacamoire, who was the MD of both of those shows, In the Heights as well as Hamilton, was our MD. So Tommy has his crew. And what's funny is we had some young cats in there that no one knew were going to be stars. So Adrienne Warren, who plays Tina Turner right now, she was the understudy for Ashanti playing Dorothy. One of the dancers is Ephraim Sykes, who's Tony Award nominee David Ruffin for Ain't Too Proud was in it. Daniel Watts, who plays Ike Turner right now, was also in The Wiz. I mean, we had everybody in that show.
This is like the most and nobody knew who show. Was this
nobody
recorded?
Knew who the hell we were, man. If you go on YouTube, you can see certain pieces of it. But nobody knew who we all were back then in 2009. And now here we are. And all of a sudden, you know, we're the folks. Which is cool.
That sounds like the most incredible, like rookie season lineup ever.
That show had that was the rookie card season. Josh Henry, Christian, Ephraim Sykes, Adrian, Daniel Watts, John Eric. I mean, we had the squad. We had the squad, man.
God. So is this just like, would you consider this like the golden era of Broadway?
I wouldn't consider the golden era of Broadway, but I would definitely consider it that moment where it was the new black kids.
there were the
older black kids, and then we were the new crew black kids, because right after that show, Memphis happened, and all of the people you see now, Brandon Victor Dixon, myself, Nick Walker, Derek Baskin, Jabinar Calloway, all these brothers were all coming up at the same time. We were all in those shows. Yeah. You know, Daniel Breaker was in Shrek, Passing Strange. We're all now like considered like, those are the guys on Broadway. You know, the college kids come up and go, can we talk to you? Like, we were those college kids when the mess started, you know.
That's freaking awesome. So being someone who, like you said, it's like the family business, you know, who's gone down that path, do you feel like you have, I don't know, I guess I always think about things where the parents are doing something and when the kids join in, like, do you feel like you have to come out of their shadow or make sure that you're not like them or perform like in a certain man? Like, do you feel that kind of pressure going into something like this?
I didn't actually, because they encouraged me, but also discouraged me. My father, they never ever made it seem like it was going to be easy. They were like, look, you got to have a thick skin because you might not make it. You're good. Yeah. And I remember going to an audition in college and my mom, and I didn't get it. And my mom, I came home, I was literally crying, Austin. I was like crying like, just crying like a baby. And my mom was like, look, if you can't handle this, then you need to stop. I was like, damn, mom. It'll be okay. She's like, look, if you can't handle it, you know how many times your father was told no, so just get used to it. And I was like, oh, all right. Yeah. I guess I got to get used to it. Like, and I happened to marry someone who's the same way. She's like, look, get it together. You didn't get the part. Shut up. Move on to the next thing. I'm like, all right, well, there you go. So I never ever felt like I had to like live up to anything. But I did feel like I had to be good because people were like, oh, you James's boy. Oh, you Sandra's boy. You can sing. And I was like, well, I have to be good because now people know I'm their kid. And I don't want to make them look bad.
Yep. They're going to, how are you going to embarrass me?
Right. Also, it was my ego. You know, my father's name is James Iglehart too. So I couldn't be, you know, the bad one.
Yeah.
Oh, there's James Luther Iglehart, and then there's the other one, his son. He's terrible. Because, you know, there are those, I won't mention, there are all those performers whose parents jumped in and like, you're like, oh, you're good. Your son sucks, but you know, hey.
Yeah.
So I didn't want to do that.
Dr. It's a shame about your son, James.
Right. It's like, really, son, it's really a shame that your son's a terrible actor. You probably should have taught him better.
Okay. Whew. Okay, I want to know more. So, like, we've talked a little bit about the group and how you guys are able to just, like, freestyle and improv. Yeah. For everybody listening, there was a time where James and I, we went to a ramen spot, Nishita Shoten, shout out.
Love it.
Long story short, by the end of our stay there, James had been freestyling to the point where the whole place was rocking with him. A guy had already paid for his meal and would just stayed to listen to him rap. Like, that's how good he is. That's what I say, like, oh, he's super talented. Like, it's because it's not like, hey, this is my friend, I gotta be nice. It's like, no, because he's actually able to do these things. So,
except for live to a game.
I mean, it's fine. It's fine.
That's true.
Exactly. What are you supposed to do? Death comes for everybody.
That's very so real.
When did you find out that you had this ability to freestyle?
You know, it's funny. It was an elementary school, and a kid. This is a real story. A kid walked up to me and was asking me about hip hop and things like that, and I knew a little bit about it. And guys were battling, and I, you know, you do what everybody else does. So like you know, you break dance, you get the stuff out, you know, you get the cardboard out, and you break dance, all that kind of crap. And then the hip hop thing happened. Well, can you rap? So I started writing little raps, but my raps weren't that great as far as like my writing skills. So
yeah,
and also in a battle, you only have a certain amount of time when you realize, oh snap, I don't have any more raps to do. Because everything I've written down, I've already said. So I got to figure out a different way to do this. So I just started like, just making stuff up. And it was just also just to annoy folks, you know. It's just like, oh, I'm bossing. I'm playing this game with Austin. Like, dude, stop rhyming. It literally was like Princess Bride. Stop with the rhymes. And I just kept doing it. So honest to God, kept doing it. And when I realized that I'm in the middle of a battle and I didn't have any more rhymes to say, I just started freestyling. And I realized, oh, most brothers who battle, they're using their written raps. They're not freestyling at all.
Yeah.
They've got bars that they already have memorized. And I just kept, you know, just doing it just because it was fun. And I had decided I was going to stop because I was like, nah, you know, I'll figure I'm going to be an R&B star. So I'm going to stop this rapping thing.
Yeah.
Then I got to high school.
I don't need this.
And this kid named Kool-Aid. I won't say his real name, but his rap name was Kool-Aid. Oh. Kid you not. He was a senior. Kid you not. He was a senior and I was a freshman and he heard I was a rapper and he was like, yo, man, I heard you rap. And so, of course, Kool-Aid had to battle everybody because, you know, high school mentality. Kool-Aid. And of course, I was a little bit more logical, but I was like, okay, I'll rap against you. And then this fool started being like mean, like, you know, but all his stuff was like, so yeah, he was like so well planned. It was so well written. And so we're battling there, you know, and every, you know, you get one cool line and everybody's like, ooh. And after a while, I started realizing that about the fourth round, his cool line started going away. And I was like, all your stuff is written. And the sixth round, I was like destroying him because I started rapping about what he was wearing. And he goes, he stops. He goes, yo, listen, I'm just saying, I put my stamp on this kid. This kid is good. He's with my crew now. And then basically he was like, please don't beat me in front of these people. So I started freestyling from the time I was like 11 years old all the way up to now, which is 35 years ago. And you just keep doing it. You practice. The fact that my wife has not killed me yet. One of our first dates, she used to have mini Beanie Babies in her car. And remember that song, Return of the Mac? Return of the Mac.
Of course.
And I'm your little. So I took one of her little ducks and I put it, and the song came on. And I started going, Return of the Quack, Return of the Quack. And she, the next day, she took all the Beanie Babies out of her car. She was like, no more freestyling for you. No more, because you can't have props because you don't know how to react.
You don't know
and,
how to
act. So no. But she and here we are 18 years of marriage later, and now she just deals with it because she knows. She's like, James, go do a show. Stop rapping to me. Stop making up songs. Go someplace. Go in the studio. Write something. Leave me the hell alone.
Can you go rap to your friends, please, honey? I'm not feeling it right now.
That's exact. So what's funny is when Freestyle first came out, she was like, James, you're doing too much. You're trying to do Broadway, trying to do this. Because at the time, I was also trying to do stand-up comedy. So I would like go out and do, you know, stand-up at night. And the Freestyle came up. She goes, you have to make a choice. And she goes, you really don't need to do this. But when she saw what Freestyle was, and she saw I would get out of her hair and be able to do this. And we did shows. Like, we were all like mad broke. And we're rapping in colleges. Like, just think about it. Lin-Manuel, like superstar Lin-Manuel right now. Utkarsh, all these boys. Yeah. Chris Jackson. We were like making like $500 a night at like a college, rapping, doing a whole show. But we loved it. So we just did it. And now you look at the brothers in the crew. But so once I joined that group, I was like, I finally found my brother and my folks to do it. And now after all these years, we ended up going to off Broadway and Broadway. Never in a million years do we think FLS, Freestyle Love Supreme, would be on Broadway. Yeah. And we did. We had a great time. Hopefully once COVID over, we're supposed to go on tour.
Guy, please. I want to see it. Oh, I want to see it in person.
Yeah. Oh my God.
I've always heard so much about it.
You are the first person I'll be calling. Please. Because you need to see it. You will lose your mind.
God. It's just, I don't think people understand how difficult it is not only to, one, be good at improv, and then to be able to improv with other people, because like solo improv is different from group improv, but then you're adding in musical elements to it, so now it's musical improv, and then it deals with freestyling, so you got to freestyle, but then you're not only freestyle, you're staying on topic to the story that you're telling. Like, there's so many things that go into it.
Our beatboxer, Shockwave, is a master improver as well. So he's improving with us, not just the beats, but he's in the scenes. He's playing people while beatboxing in the scenes. And Arthur, the Geniuses, who is our keyboardist, as well as Ian Bergetime and Kurt and Bill Sherman, they're all improving the music. Nothing's been rehearsed. Everything they're playing is happening while you're watching it. And we also have this girl named Kayla Kaiser Rose. She's one of our beatboxers. We have Anissa. We have like some dope ass ladies as well who are just
I was gonna say, you got a ton of people. Ladies and gentlemen, you have been hearing about the illustrious life and talents of James Iglehart. Now, James, is there anything that you want to let people know that you didn't have a chance to touch on through our current conversation?
I love entertainment. I love comic books. I love video games. I love professional wrestling. It's one of my favorite things to do. I should say. And if you get a chance, check out on Disney Plus. You'll see Rapunzel's Tangled Adventures. I play Lance Strongbow. And look for my voice in DuckTales coming up. And hopefully, when Broadway opens back up, you will see me in Hamilton and have a good time.
Ooh! And so we got to go because we got to film a retro roulette episode. And that is where I will dig in to some questions about wrestling with James Iglehart, ladies and gentlemen. James, where can they find you on social media?
They can find me on Twitter at James M. Iglehart. You can find me on Instagram at JM Iglehart. We just did the Hamilton cast and I just did this really, really fun thing called Saturday Night on Broadway, where we take a couple songs, remix them to what's happening now with COVID, and it's called Mask, and it's really, really funny. Check it out on the Hamilton Instagram, and also check it out on mine. You'll have a good time. It's a lot of fun.
Oh yeah, perfect. And y'all know you can catch me on Instagram and Twitter at Xavier Woods PhD. Follow the channel at Up Up Down Down without the O's, and obviously as well, catch me on Twitch, twitch.tv/AustinCreed, and listen to the New Day podcast every Monday, baby. Until next time, always and forever, keep it tight. Da 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 da